Good evening. Welcome. As we worship this evening, we will be going through a series of readings and reflections. There is a hymn and then also some song responses that are printed in your bulletin when we are in the later part of the service. So we will remain seated for those. We will be standing for the first hymn, and also we will be receiving communion this evening silently. So when we get to that time, we're going to be pouring juice into cups and offering bread, so you'll be invited to come forward at that time as you're ready to receive bread, and some juice will be poured in a cup for you, and you can receive that those elements as you are ready. We gather again on this Good Friday at the foot of the cross, which calls us onward not in shame, not in fear, but more deeply into the costly journey towards life. There is wounding, there is weeping. In Jesus, as the promised one, God is not separated from that.
Please rise as you're able for our opening sentences. O God, true source of humanity, mother and father of us all, you renew us so we may grow like you.
We gather together.
From corner or limelight, from fears or from sadness, from hope or from gladness, in close relationships or from separate lives.
We gather together.
Who long for the company, the leveling, and the deepest joys found in your presence.
We gather together.
To meet you, to celebrate your love, and to rejoice in the possibilities that arise when we honor all the diversity our humanity.
We gather together with you.
Please remain standing as you're able to sing together.
Give us faith.
had called and disciples followed. They listened to his words, words that always spoke of the love of the one who sent him. He wouldn't, however, speak to those who accused him. There were no words of hatred or revenge. He spoke the words of God, and those words were silenced by the violence of humanity.
The word of God is still silenced by violence and cruelty. The word of God is stifled by fear and embarrassment. For the times when we have stood by and allowed the word to be suppressed and silenced,
we humbly seek God's forgiveness. Jesus offered the healing touch of divine love to the untouchable and the unlovable. Powers of the world, however, tore him away from them with the destructive touch of fear's violence. Those who had found wholeness in his presence were left to share in his suffering.
Those who love are still wrenched apart by cruel hands. There is no chance to say goodbye. There is no way to ease the pain of pardon. For the times we have been immune to the pain of refuge, nor the cries of those in agony of separation,
we humbly seek God's forgiveness. When Jesus was only days old, Mary was told that a sword would pierce her heart. Her spirit had rejoiced in God's lifting up of the lowly and bringing down of the powerful. Yet in the crucifixion, the powers of domination seemed to reign supreme. When he asked from the cross if he had been forgotten, he spoke for humanity.
People still stand at the foot of the cross, sharing the agony of those they love, witnessing the anguish of abandonment by those who could make a difference. The people with power and authority, they wonder where God has gone. For the times when we have allowed people to be abandoned to evil forces, when we have failed to act or speak on their behalf,
we humbly seek God's forgiveness. Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. In the midst of extreme suffering, at the depths of despair, in the face of death, a thief saw in Jesus his only hope. While some abandoned him, some laughed, some wept, one that being crucified beside him found in Jesus his only hope.
To lose hope is the worst agony. To be afraid of oblivion, part of the human condition. To call on the name of Jesus is a sign of hope in despair. For the times when we have lost hope and given away to fear, failing to call on the name of Jesus,
we humbly seek God's forgiveness.
When the time was right, God sent Jesus to be among us. Born into this life, seeing your grace revealed in all things, he laughed with those who laughed and mourned with those who mourned. Through your love, he healed the sick. He welcomed the outcast. He challenged those in power and the structures that kept them there. And he called us back to your love. In the power of the Holy Spirit, the Christ laughs and cries, heals and welcomes, challenges and loves, again and again and again. We have been told that on the night before he was taken to be tortured to death on a cross, Jesus sat with his disciples, ate with them in a meal of remembrance.
Jesus took a loaf of bread, asked your blessing upon it, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and eat it. This is me, my body, given for you. Each time you eat it, remember me. Close to the meal's end, he took a cup filled with wine, asked your blessing upon it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and drink it. This is me. This is my promise in life's blood. poured out for you and for the world. Each time you drink it, remember me. So we, his disciples, eat bread and drink wine and remember. Let us pray. Holy One, pour out your Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and cup. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we might be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his love. All honor and glory are yours, the Creator Almighty. As in your name we pray. Amen.
The table is set. Come as you eat.
The elders of the people and the chief priests and scribes rose and they brought Jesus before Pilate. They began their accusation by saying, "We found this man inciting our people to revolt, opposing payment of tribute to Caesar, and claiming to be Christ, a king." Pilate put Jesus this question, "Are you the king of the Jews?" "It is you who say it," Jesus replied.
"I remember a man who had dreams of what might be, that people would be set free from ideas and images about God that enslaved them, that people would believe that through their everyday acts of human kindness, they are intimately connected with the sacred, that people would live in peace in God's presence all the days of their lives. I remember a man driven by his dreams." Pilate then said to the chief priests and the crowds, "I find no case against this man." But they persisted, "He is inflaming the people with his teaching all over Judea. It has come all the way from Galilee, where he began, down to here."
"I remember a man who had his moments of breakthrough, but it must have seemed his dream was being realized. The times people really listened and responded. The men and women who were prepared to walk with him and support him. Times when he spoke better and more convincingly than other times. I remember a man enthused by his success."
Now scornful we serve thee.
he asked if the man was a Galilean. And finding that he came under Herod's jurisdiction, he passed him over to Herod, who was also in Jerusalem at that time. Herod was delighted to see Jesus. He had heard about him and had been wanting for a long time to set eyes on him. He was hoping to see some miracle worked by Jesus. So Herod questioned Jesus at some length, but without getting a reply.
I remember a man who learned of the cruel death of his cousin. He got into a boat, seeking a lonely place where he could be with his friends to absorb the shock, to grieve quietly, and to calm the feelings of powerlessness and frustration and fear for his own future. I wonder what he prayed about that night. I wonder what helped him leave that lonely place and go forward to confront life, rather than retreat into isolation and safety. I remember a man driven by his convictions. Then Herod, together with his guards, treated Jesus with contempt and made fun of him. Herod put a rich cloak on Jesus and sent him back to Pilate. And though Herod and Pilate had been enemies before, they were reconciled that same day. Pilate then summoned the chief priests and the leaders of the people. "You brought this man before me," Pilate said, "as a political agitator. Now I have gone into the matter myself, in your presence, and found no case against him, in respect of all the charges you bring against him. Nor has Herod either, since he has sent him back to us. As you can see, the man has done nothing that deserves death. So I shall have him flogged and then let him go." But altogether they howled, "Away with him! Give us Barabbas!" Pilate was anxious to set Jesus free and address them again. But they shouted back, "Crucify him! Crucify him!"
I remember a man whose dream was shattered. He broke down and cried over what could have been. Who knew the pain of failure and powerlessness. Who knew what it was like to feel broken and terribly alone. I remember someone human, like all of us. My blood was transgressed. Pilate released Barabbas, whom they asked for, and who had been imprisoned for rioting and murder, and handed Jesus over to them to deal with as they pleased.
I remember a man who knew he was going to die, who gathered with his friends knowing it was for the last time, who spoke to them about what he really believed, who wanted them to remember him and to keep his dream alive. I remember a testament to love. Jesus there, with the two criminals also, one on the right, the other on the left. Jesus prayed, "Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing." Dividing up his clothes, they gambled for them. The people stood there staring at Jesus, and the ringleaders made faces, taunting. "He saved others. Let's see him save himself."
I remember a man crucified. He was a failure, abandoned by his male friends, taunted, despised, enduring a shameful and agonizing death. No consoling or heartfelt presence of his God to help him. I remember a man whose faith in all he believed was tested to the limits. It was about midday when a darkness fell over the whole region, and the darkness remained until mid-afternoon. At some point during this darkness, the curtain in the temple was torn in two. Then Jesus exclaimed, "Father, I entrust my spirit into your hands." And with those words, he exhaled, then breathed no more.
Oh.